Hello, I'm Yiska. Welcome to my talk about Nitto vacuum cleaners, which I call Pinky and Brain are taking over the world with vacuum cleaners because of some internals in the firmware. So I work for the university, and every now and then, so around the end of the year, we have some money that we can spend on bigger things. And my student asked me, like, can we buy some IoT stuff? And well, what should we buy? It should have Wi-Fi and maybe a cloud connection. And then we were like, yeah, maybe a laser would be cool, like for science or something, and sound. And it would be cool if it cleans my office or something and has USB, but the office cleaning, it's more like optional. So the older Nitto vacuum cleaners had some Linux system, and people were mounting Raspberry Pis on them to run some stuff on a console. But the newer ones, they have a bit more limited options. They are closed source. They still have this UI and USB thing. And if you buy the connected variant, you can connect it to an app. So it cleans anyway, but you need an app if you want to get like a map of your home or other stuff. Or like you are at work and you want to start the vacuum cleaner to clean your house. So what the app does is it opens some WebSocket, and then you can, for example, use your Wi-Fi or configure your Wi-Fi and send some manual commands directly. And during this initial pairing with the app, you also connect to a Beehive cloud with your account information, and the robot also gets this account information. So there is this Beehive cloud for your user account at Nitto, but there's a second cloud connected called Nucleo. And whenever you want to do something like cleaning, you normally send a command to this cloud via WebSocket. Then some stuff happens, so there's mutual SSL authentication encryption going on. But in the end, you will get, like, for example, the map or the status of your vacuum cleaner back. So this is a lot of interfaces, components, stuff that could be broken, but it's also very complicated to understand, like, where can you start to attack something. So the student whom I gave this to in the beginning, he really had some struggles, like, finding out what is going on and what to do, but he found out some funny things. So, for example, he took two smartphones, and you first pair the robot with the first smartphone, then you take the second smartphone, and with the old smartphone and the old account, which is a different account, you can still interfere in this manual drive mode. So you can still send some commands, even though that's not the valid user anymore. And what actually happens is, if you are in this robot manual driving session, you can override commands as long as there is one active session, another one can just send commands also. But yeah, you need to have this active session, so it's a bit limited attack. Anyway, it might be funny, like someone else is just controlling the robot, and then you tell the robot, yeah, but jump down those stairs or something, you could do that. For this, you would connect to the WebSocket, and it has this drive part, and then you can send an authentication header, which is obviously wrong if you have the old account, and then you get this message invalid authorization header. But nevertheless, except for the vacuum on and off, all these drive commands are still interpreted. So, might be the next party game, I don't know. Now it's still a bit, yeah, more like a party game, because there needs to be this active session. So the next question was, like, can we fake or replay authorization? So if you are in the network, once overheard this authentication, can you do something? Yes, you can. Replay is possible. And then we were setting, like, we knew, like, how is this authentication made, and we just forged some other authentication packages with timestamps from before 1970, so before Unix time, and it works. Whatever. So you can perform the previous attack as often as you want and also start the engine, but it's still limited to being present in the network while there was one disauthentication and so on. So you can still only do this manual drive mode. It's cool, it's funny, but it's not yet something that is that bad. So we were looking into this initial pairing. What happens there is you use the smartphone app and you enter your Nitro account credentials and your Wi-Fi credentials. And then there is a put request to robot initialize, and it says your SSID and the user ID. So far, so nice. And then your robot is configured and connected to this Beehive cloud and so on. But it's not closed. So as long as someone is in your network, he can steal your Nitro and connect to his account. So, I mean, the old cleaning reports will not be there, but the person can start cleaning and then get a map of your apartment. So that's the stuff that we found on these interfaces. So we thought, yeah, it would be nice to maybe also analyze the firmware. So maybe there's more going on in this firmware. And the firmware update, it even for the connected variant, still comes via USB. So you connect a USB stick to it and put the firmware on it. But the good thing is you can therefore download this from the internet, so from the vendor. And it's actually the same format for Nitro and Vorwerk. Vorwerk, they just bought Nitro some time ago. And they have some pattern, which is this like separating parts in the firmware, which is 1, 2, 3, 4 hex. It starts with a firmware version, the vendor, the hardware model, and then there is some certificate information and encrypted stuff. But there is a plaintext user interface and some footer. The bad part is you cannot flip any byte in there. So if you flip something, in the end, it will complain and not install this update. But we can still take a look in this user interface. Why not? It's just a couple of XML files and style definitions, and the fonts are all images, so each character is an image in there, which is then included somewhere and so on. And these XML files, they are pretty funny. So there was this main UI file which had a comment which just says, like, this is XML, but please be careful, just keep the text in the same order because it's parsed not really by an XML parser, but we handmade this with some love and it's more performant probably. And this was the part when we said, yeah, okay, now we cannot change the firmware and not analyze things, so we should open the hardware. But my student, he's more a person who likes all this web stuff and web interfaces, and it was a bit out of scope from his thesis. So I did the stuff to the vacuum cleaner that he didn't want to do, and robots were harmed. So there is, for this robot, there's one documented port, this USB port, and you can connect to this and say some commands. They are almost the same for the newer vacuum cleaners as for the old ones, but some parts are no longer supported, like actually some firmware access is limited. But there's on this vacuum cleaner a serial console, which is there. And if you do this reboot, not with the power button, but actually with this test mode on and reboot, then you will get some boot menu. And it says, press X for serial download using Xmodem 1K, ancient technology. Download actually means that it's like a netboot, so you upload a firmware image from which it will boot. So you cannot really retrieve the firmware like this, but you can boot something. And now the question is, okay, how do I boot something on a system about that I don't know anything? So there's a chip on it, then you Google it. You cannot really find something except for these last few characters, which are a form factor for a certain chip family from TI. And that's sufficient enough. So there's this challenge, can you boot this? Yeah, so Foundry 27, they have some images. For QNX IFS, so QNX is the thing that according to Wikipedia and so on runs on this Nito. And they have this, so you can upload this via the serial, take some time, and if it's successful, this happens, it actually prints some stuff, transfer complete, and then it crashes. So it's not really correct, but it's somewhat correct. So it prints and it does something. So we need to actually compile our own system into this. So there's QNX, there's a software development package. It did not really work for me with this 30-day trial, but normally that should work, and then you don't have to hack this license management. It's not that secure anyway. but it should work. I mean, it's their business model, so I won't tell you in detail how. And then you can try to boot this stuff. So there's a lot of proprietary options, which means the memory mapping is a bit different. And each time you access memory in a way where it's mapped differently, it will crash. And there is this EMMC with a lot of data on it, probably, but you cannot access this because it's a bit different in the system, and accessing the standard memory addresses doesn't work, and so on. So I really tried to get a memory map of this and trying everything that was like in the standard document for this chip family and so on, and it crashed a lot, and then it crashed again, and it crashed again. And then I was like, what should I do? Well, what can I do? I can kprintf. And I kprintf, and then there's QNX, which is on that chip normally on this hex address 81 million, and accessing this worked. So, what can I do? Well, I had this crazy idea, and I never thought this could work at all, but it worked. So I boot into this Nito system, I did a reboot, and then directly rebooted into my own system, which just did a kprintf starting from this 80 million hex. Next time when I will do this, I will maybe do some SIP and base64 on top, because that was very, very, very slow. And then it's actually the memory from the system. And there's nothing cleared. I mean, I did a reboot, but there is no hardware reinitialization in between. There's some memory mapping unit again, so it's actually not 2 gigabytes, but just 256 megabytes of data, but okay. And so I have the data, and within this, they have this QNX IFS, which is uncompressed, something like 20 megabytes, and it's just there in plain text, and it's not overridden because it needs to be there in place, and all the operating processes are then mapped somewhere else. And I got this image. So now you need to understand a bit about those images and the QNX boot process. So this image starts with a startup header, where also the address where you will copy it to is noted, so this 81 and so on. Then you have a startup part, which is the original startup, so where I also did the kprintf, so which initializes all the hardware. And then there is the interesting part, so to say, because it also has a file system. And in this file system, there are a lot of files included that you can later on, for example, extract. So there is this dump IFS tool, which I use, and then you can use DD to extract files. It's probably not meant to do this like this, but yeah, you just use whatever works. And there is Pinky and Brain. So, yeah, I tried to repack this, but you also need to compress this. This works. I did something like all checksums were correct, but it still didn't boot. So it's still a bit to do there, to boot my own system. But at least I analyzed a lot of things in there. So what is Pinky? What is Brain? Pinky is more this service in the background which checks, like, are you still alive and so on. It's there's still to do in the shell script, which runs Pinky, but yeah, I mean, it works. And then there is the brain, so you can maybe see that in the file name up there, so it's the brain shell script, which is studying the robot, so the robot is so to say the brain, and this file is really, really, really huge, so there's all the logic in there, like, am I driving in a room, am I entering the next room, and so on, so all the things that you see when you, like, put your vacuum cleaner on top of a table and really check, is it never falling down, is it really never falling down, so all the logic is in there. The brain has options. So if you open it in IDA, you might find this part here, and it has telnet. It's not a default option, so that's like one of the plans. So as soon as I put my own image, I will probably enable telnet. Why not? But I mean, even that it is still there, and there's like all the routines for telnet in there, so it's not like they recompile something, it's just an option. And the next interesting part is that there is core dumps. So QNX by default puts core dumps in a temporary dumper file, and the core dump actually includes the complete binary that crashed. So the complete bin robot and so on, or the complete whatever. But there is this part here which says RC4 crypt. So they don't directly copy it, but they encrypt it. And then you have the option on the robot, so if you connect a USB stick, to copy some log files which include the core dumps, but encrypted. So the question is, like, what is RC4 crypt? How is it encrypted and so on? Well, they call it directly also for log files without any password argument. So, So where is the passphrase? Is there something? And yeah, why do they have their own bin RC4? So you open this in IDA, then you still need like to mark some arguments in the correct way, and then, yeah, that's actually the password. So this star something, 9 characters. And with this, you can decrypt the core dumps, which are copied to USB. And yeah, the core dump contains this complete file, which means, so even if you don't have access to this firmware, because firmware extracting really it's a nasty thing with the serial console and so on, if you crash something, you will get a core dump, you can analyze it, you know what crashed it, what was on the stack in the registers and so on. And yeah, even bin robot can crash. I mean, why? Is it like the vacuum cleaner drives around and says, oh, a unicorn, let me crash? Why should cleaning crash the robot? And then I tried something, so I have friends who trust me when I say, please let me connect to your vacuum robot. And so even for this older ones which are not connected, you can decrypt with the same password. And yes, bin robot crashed, so there was a bin robot core dump. And then there is something else which was very nice. So they have build details in there. And I mean, the connected is like the newest one which we bought back then. I mean, yeah, half a year ago or something, but still. And the image is, in meanwhile, it's 2 years old. So they are running like 2 year old software on a connected device. If that's the updated version already. And there was the name of the alpha, so I removed that name, but I still show you the Facebook page. It's great. So that I mean, it's not really his business anymore. He worked there before we started analyzing the stuff. Yeah, that's him. And we tried to contact Nito, so telling them, your things are maybe not that secure. So we started at March 12th and said, like, hello. And then we tried the German customer care, said, like, hello. And they said, yeah, we forwarded this to the developers. And then I tried Twitter, and then they said, yeah, the ticket exists. And then I tried some other stuff, and again, like, yeah, the ticket exists. And each time, so I just saved the screenshot for the German one, but each time you get also this survey if you were happy with the service. And then you can say, no, I was not. But nothing happens. So that's very, very funny, but not really helpful. So the problem was my student was going to hand in his thesis on May 19, and I was like, they maybe should know it before. I mean, handing in a thesis means it's in the library, so people can access it. So I tried again, and I was also including this build information. And yeah, again, not really a response. I mean, what is this? They were not really interested. And I guess that's the problem. Like, they were different people. They had different first names, at least. But they don't have any access rights in the system. They cannot really say, yeah, this is important or something. And it just stays with the same problems. So there's some things that we still want to do. So we know which payloads we're causing Discord dumps, so stuff that crashes. So maybe we can wirelessly take over vacuum cleaners. That would really be a cool thing. And the other part would be to have your own firmware, so replacing this Nucleo and Nitro Cloud there, so that you are not leaking your private information anymore to any servers. Now I brought you some advertisements. So if you like this talk, you might also like some other work of other students from me. So there's Internal Blue, which is some Bluetooth hacking and Broadcom chips tomorrow at 2 p.m. Then during this lightning talks, there's a student who looked into the Equiva smart locks. And another smart lock will be tomorrow, I think, 6:45, about Nello. Will be also very, very entertaining. And then during my work, I often need to talk to other people, explain them, like, what does a vacuum cleaner do? And last time I tried this, what happens was, like, yeah, the thing is doing the laser phase and the Wi-Fi. What you see there is actually a Xiaomi, so it's not having some ARM, but it has, or it's a different architecture. So it's having this quad-core processor and Ubuntu on it. And then I was trying to explain to the reporter, like, what it's doing. And then he was saying, yes, surveillance chip. Okay. But, I mean, my unicorn was on TV. Yeah, and I also used some images for this talk. That's it. Ooh, tons of questions. Do we have a microphone for this? I have it.
Yeah, that works. Have you tried hooking into the SSL connections to the cloud?
Not yet. So there is the certificates in there. I mean, exchanging them would be easy, but yeah, would be also a nice thing to send something. I guess they don't expect that the vacuum cleaner actually sends back something invalid. I mean, they trust it. They have the certificates on it.
Sounds like a good way to just inject some code in the cloud.
Yeah.
Have you? Are those scripts really called Pinky and Brain?
Yes. Yes. I mean, I can also continue now showing you a bit more of the scripts. Yes. Yes. Is that it? That's a yes. No, that's the other one. You can continue with the next question while I'm looking for the file, actually.
I'd like to see slide 17 again.
Slide 17.
Don't try the pressure.
17, what was there? Yeah, there's more. That is also a thing. There's way more files.
So the last file has a very interesting name.
Yes. There is more of those keys. That's why I put it in there. So that's actually like the interesting names which I included, and I excluded the rest, like what was fitting on the file here.
Did you look at it?
Yes. It's like some keys. Yes, it's keys. I mean, yeah. what?
So.
No, not TXT, like real asymmetric keys.
So you said you couldn't upload your own firmware.
Yeah.
Did you look into the crypto they use? Because when they already implement their own crypto for the RC4?
No, it's like mostly OpenSSL.
Okay.
I mean, there's a few more things, but it's mainly OpenSSL.
Okay.
It's not all handmade.
What is this Beehive thing? Is it just a server name or?
Yeah, Beehive is the cloud part which does authentication, and Nucleo is the cloud part which does cleaning, I guess.
Okay, but it's not a software called Beehive, but just the name of the cloud.
Yeah, and then the internal service is like Astro, and I think Astro connects to Beehive, or Cometa connects to, I don't know.
Okay.
So I have a mess of files here, but somewhere I also have the. So which one? The brain shell script probably might be interesting. Still need to change the font size. So that's the brain. Yeah. So it's opening this UI, and that's actually also the things it shows during boot. And yeah, frame buffer something, and then that's this main while loop, and this is the part that I had on my slide. And then again, the UI, whatever, blah, blah. Lots of love. And then there is this dumper with the RC4 crypt and some unmounting. And I have some more files in the same folder. I don't know. So that's actually all the files of this IFS. Lots of files. There's your key. Yeah. More questions? Okay. Yeah, one question. What? Yes. Yeah, we didn't so far, but yeah. So man-in-middling, this is one of the things that we still need to do, so understanding this whole communication. So if you want to replace the cloud, you actually need to know what is being sent to the cloud and what is being sent back and so on. Yeah. That's still missing. But yeah, it's in there. It's just more work. Okay, any more requests except from opening the passphrase files? Which I probably won't do here on stage. Okay, then thanks for listening.